This episode of Musical Hell is brought to you by Midnight Musicals. Welcome to the podcast Musical Underground. And by Cafe Himbo Cookbooks, celebrating his 10th anniversary. Thank you. Ambiguity. What would vitriolic internet discourse be without it? For example, Melchior Gabor and Wendla Bergman, star-crossed lovers doomed by the hypocritical and apathetic adults around them, or smug pseudo-intellectual date rapist and his unwitting victim. You can make arguments either way, for their musical incarnations at least. The source material is rather less ambiguous, which is why today we're talking about Frühlingserwachen, eine Kindertragödie by Frank Wedekind. Written in 1891, this is the first of Wedekind's plays, but due to its subject matter, it didn't see production until 15 years later, and even then several scenes were censored. Which is ironic, considering Frühlingserwachen is an incisive treatise against the repressive attitudes which prevented it from being staged. Much of the experiences of the play's young characters mirrors Wedekind's own adolescence. He was insecure and struggled in school, like Moritz, he came to atheism as a result of his studies, like Melchior, and he was all too familiar with adolescent suicide, with two classmates and a younger brother all dying by their own hands. So, here's how it originally went down. The play is a series of loosely connected scenes of life in a middle-class German community, with most of the focus on the private lives of a group of young teenagers. Principal among them are Wendla Bergman, whose mother keeps her in the dark about reproductive matters but who has an insatiable curiosity and an inclination towards masochism, Moritz Stiefel, whose poor school performance and anxiety are exacerbated by confusing wet dreams, and Melchior Gabor, who, unlike the other two, has done some reading about sex and provides an instructive essay to Moritz. Melchior's influence only ends up making the situations of the other two worse. The essay makes Moritz more anxious, and Wendla suffers from Melchior losing control twice. First, when an experiment in being beaten gets out of hand, and second, when Melchior forces himself on her in a hayloft. Ultimately, Moritz is unable to cope with academic failure and lack of assistance from the adults around him, and he kills himself. The children are saddened by his loss, but the adults dismiss Moritz as undeserving and selfish and use Melchior and his essay as a scapegoat. When his parents discover Melchior's relationship with Wendla, which has resulted in her pregnancy, much to her own confusion, even his indulgent mother is unable to defend him anymore, and he's sent to a reformatory. He escapes and seeks out Wendla, only to find her name on a gravestone declaring she has died of anemia. The dead Moritz appears to Melchior and tempts him to join Moritz in death, but while Melchior is considering the offer, a masked figure suddenly appears, rebuking Moritz's shade. The masked man explains Wendla died of a botched abortion forced on her by her mother, and offers to help Melchior gain a better understanding of the world. Melchior agrees and goes with him, and Moritz goes back to his grave to decompose in peace. The biggest change between the play and the musical version is the nature of Melchior and Wendla's sexual encounter. The scene in the original is explicitly non-consensual, but musical book writer Steven Sater didn't want audiences to lose empathy for Melchior and attempted to make Wendla a willing partner. Unfortunately, the result winds up in a very murky gray area. The crux of Wendla's arc is that she doesn't know anything about sex or the possible consequences, so how can she give meaningful consent? Does declaring she's okay with the outcome and whispering have any bearing on the fact she didn't know what she was getting into? For that matter, does Melchior even understand how little Wendla knows and how dubious his actions are as a result? In the end, it might not matter, as Spring Awakening is ultimately a cautionary tale. Not for children, but for adults. Wedekind subtitled his play A Children's Tragedy, and like all good dramatic tragedies, the arc of the story is dictated by innate flaws which render the tragedy inevitable. But the fatal flaw is not on the part of the young characters, but the parents and society that reared them. Wedekind pulls back the curtain on adolescent life to show how puritanism, rigidity, and indifference not only do nothing to curb teenage tendencies, puberty's gonna do what puberty's gonna do, but creates a toxic culture that destroys the innocence it presumes to protect. Wendla and Moritz, caught unawares by their development, end up adrift and bewildered in ways that ultimately contribute to their untimely deaths. Melchior, meanwhile, has gained some knowledge on his own, but cannot use it responsibly. He's a child playing with matches. Nor does the conspiracy of silence protect Martha and Ilsa from the abuses they endure. Each in their own way suffers simply for the crime of growing into adulthood without a roadmap. And worst of all, they are blamed and punished for their failures by the same adults whose actions have doomed them. Which brings us to the masked man. This deus ex machina of a character is unquestionably Wiedekind's self-insert. He even played the role in early productions, but what it represents is more up to interpretation. Translator Francis J. Ziegler identifies the masked man as the personification of life, in contrast to the death represented by Moritz's ghost. Going on this theory, it makes sense that the musical cuts out the middleman and has Melchior come to his own conclusions. But I think the masked man also represents something that Spring Awakening has, until that point, lacked, a sympathetic adult influence. Melchior is still young, and the young need guidance, not rigid discipline or overprotective limitation, but patient understanding and assistance in growing into the person they're meant to become. Both the play and the musical carry the message that the circumstances which led to the children's tragedy can and should be changed. The difference is the musical aims this message at the younger generation, and the play aims it at the elder. But both can benefit from hearing it.
Parents are the same, no matter time, no place. They don't understand that us kids are going to make some mistakes. So to you other kids all across the land, there's no need to argue, parents just don't understand.